All right, so good morning, everybody, and I welcome you all on behalf of all my co-organizers from TIFR, CBS, BRC, and IIT Bombay. So effectively, this QMAT is organized by all the institutions in Mumbai who have this kind of activities. Okay, so we are entering our fourth year of QMAT. We started this in 2018 with a view to bring the community together and also to promote younger colleagues who are the future of this community. And I am told that once you have crossed 3 years with an annual meeting like this, it is here to stay. So I hope that this is now an annual feature that we all look forward to. Okay, so without much delay, what I will first do is to request Professor Ramakrishnan, who is more known to us as Ramki, currently the TIFR director, but also one of the pioneers of low temperature physics in India, to say a few words and to inaugurate the conference.
Thank you, Pratap. On behalf of TIFR, I welcome all of you to this QMAT 4 online conference. I remember the first conference because I was a speaker there, and it was a very successful conference done at ISER Mohali. And at the end of the conference, I think everybody felt that QMAT research will flourish. And I'm happy to note that the QMAT research in India has more breadth and depth now, and that is easily corroborated by the talks announced at this conference. Quantum materials, as we know, it has, broadly speaking, it has materials with strong electron correlations, as well as materials which are linked to non-generic quantum effects, such as topological insulators and Dirac electron systems and so on. So the understanding of these materials, we all know, cannot come from classical, semi-classical cosmic particles or low-level quantum mechanics. So the appeal of working in this quantum material at this point is largely due to the complexity and emergent properties of quantum materials, how they challenge our understanding on the properties of matter. But more practical people among us would also like to see these quantum materials with exotic electronics properties may enable completely new applications with novel routes to perform quantum computation, quantum communication, and so on. I think applications have to happen. I mean, once we are getting into a slightly major field, I think there is going to be a talk on this direct application of this in this conference as well. People are thinking that this is the second quantum revolution, the study of quantum materials and these applications. And in some sense, they are saying that, their quantum materials in the 21st century is what happened with semiconductors in the 20th century. That is, I think, pushing it too far right now. But I think that is the goal. I mean, we had so many interesting breakthrough phenomena. I remember still 50 years ago, the heavy fermion physics came in 1975. Of course, nobody realized that it was that significant result in 75. It's only in the 80s, other new systems started coming in. And then the heavy fermions, though it didn't have any direct applications, but it brought us new concept both from the experiment and the theory side. Things like non-Fermi liquids, quantum phase transitions, all have come from there. But then later the HITC came, there was a lot of hype and, there was a lot of excitement and so on. But the practical applications of that has been hindered because of the metallurgy. But right now, as far as quantum material is concerned, I think we are in a better position to harness if there is any, as I said, novel ground states or novel properties which could be used for the possibility of devices. And that is one thing we would certainly consider it. And you have a variety, this quantum materials, we have nicely coupled things which are strongly correlated, and this non-generic quantum systems such as topological insulators and Dirac electron systems. So we have a wide range of materials to deal with, and also each of them is very important, both from the fundamental point of view as well as from the application point of view. So for instance, the wave function of the magnetic electron in a quantum spin liquid can become entangled, and that has possibly a practical applications which still to be realized. Then emergent defects in the quantum fluctuating states called quasi-particle supplant the individual electrons in moving parts of the solid. The fermions in quantum Hall effects materials, which are composite of magnetic fields and electrons, and other exotic examples, in addition, electrons in unconventional superconductors form a collective quantum state. That is another area which is, which has been there for some time and it's still continuing. And the other examples are, skirmions, which is essentially magnetic vertices of different kind. And of course, there is interesting exotic examples of bubbles in superfluid helium 4. I think that's going to be the first talk in the parallel session, which is treated as a soft quantum nanomaterials. So I think there is, I wish I was 40 years younger to get into this field, and there is more opportunities. And unlike the ITC, I think devices and the applications are more reality here, and possibly we will reach the second revolution in quantum physics in this effort. So without taking more of time, I'm sure looking at the program, the conference is going to be an unqualified success. My best wishes to all of you who are part of this research. Thank you. Over to Pratap. Pratap, you're muted.
Oh, okay. All right. There are some speakers who are in the other room, so I have to tell them that this was the one for the welcome. All right. So thank you, Ramki, for your nice words and your wishes for this conference. So we are exactly on time. Some brief announcements before we start. First thing is my request to all the speakers, as I have repeatedly mentioned, please mention the time. The chairs should also be extremely particular so that the time is maintained, because we have a very busy schedule. We have a policy of that people speak only in alternate years. No one speaks in consecutive years. But yet the community is growing, and if we have to keep it within 4 days, we need to have a busy schedule. Second thing is that the breakout room feature of Zoom is something that you can use for extending any discussion after the talk for some few minutes before you come back in. It's very easy and intuitive to use. You have to press the breakout room, go into any of the breakout room with the person you want to discuss with, have your conversation, and then when you leave, you can come back to the main session. Third thing is that the posters in frames, I hope all of you by now have explored frames at least once. That session is a very important session for us, because these are young people, these are students, postdocs who are presenting their work, and we cannot give everyone an oral presentation because of lack of time. Though we have 1/3 of the lectures which are by junior speakers here. So therefore, please visit the poster session whenever you have time. It will be open 24/7. You can go anytime there. There are discussions area, there are whiteboards, you can have discussions there. Okay, so with this, let me not delay anymore. This Zoom session, the parallel session 1 will continue here. Those who want to be on parallel session 2, they have to log out of this Zoom and go to through the other Zoom link. So I think we'll just wait for 2 minutes for people to redistribute into whichever session they want to be, and then we'll start the session. All right. So the first session, the first parallel session one will be chaired by Ovik B. And there will also be a technical coordinator to take care of any glitches that we might face. So may I request Ovik to take over and initiate the session.
Hi. Thank you, Pratap. Am I audible?
Yes, perfect.
Okay, thank you. So the first talk is by Ambarish Ghosh from IISc. He will be talking about his experiments on bubbles in superfluid helium 4. Ambarish, over to you, please.
Thank you, Abhik. Well, I'm trying to share my screen. Need some help there because it seems I'm not allowed to share my screen yet.
I guess you will have to be given permission by the to share the screen.
It's given now. You should.
Yeah. Is this working right now?
Yes, Ambarish. We can see your screen.
But are you seeing the full screen or just?
As a presenter, the presenter screen.
Oh, I need to change this then. Give me a second, please. Slideshow. That should work. I hope this is okay, Ovik.
Yes, perfect. Perfect.
Okay, great. Great. Thank you. Thank you, firstly, to the organizers for inviting me and to speak. It's always a pleasure to interact with our colleagues, especially after this difficult 2 years that we have had. Although virtual, still I look forward to some fruitful one-to-one interactions during the talks. Also, Vic, thank you for your introduction. I'm going to talk about these experiments, these results that we have obtained in bubbles in helium-4. That was very recently published, and we're very excited about this new avenue. And just let me tell you, it has a couple of things. It has electrons, 6 and 8 electrons. It has bubbles, and it has superfluid helium-4. So in this talk, the concentration or the focus on helium-4 will be minimal. This is just one slide. And just to remind you, this is the phase diagram of helium-4. And helium-4 is a very interesting liquid, a very interesting quantum material in which it remains liquid up to 0 Kelvin temperature, at least at lower pressures. And below a certain temperature, it forms a superfluid state. The properties of the superfluid states are very interesting. It's basically the phase transition. It's known as the lambda transition, in which the helium goes, the specific heat has the shape of lambda when plotted as a function of temperature. And superfluidity is known because the name comes from the fact that the flow of superfluid apparently happens through without any viscosity. So for example, in a capillary of about a micron, it can move at a velocity of few centimeters per second. Also interesting, the superfluid helium has an enormous thermal conductivity. So for example, as you see in this video, this is a pot of normal liquid helium-4. Slowly the temperature is being reduced. And as the temperature crosses through the lambda point, you will see all the bubbling ceases to exist. And this is really because all the gas-filled bubbles below superfluid helium cannot sustain because the heat is just taken away almost instantly. So now the system has been taken through a superfluid transition. You can get this video in YouTube. So this is basically a 30-second review of superfluid helium. I'm not going to talk much about it. I'm just going to take the superfluid helium as just some material in which electrons reside. So this is the brief outline of the talk. I'm going to have a largish introduction in which we're going to talk about how electrons in Helium can have multiple different configurations, and how some of these configurations can have this sort of a bridge between soft matter physics and quantum effects is very, very unique, at least in this sort of a nanometer scale. And we have a very niche experimental technique which allows us to probe these materials in detail. This is the acoustic cavitation technique. And using this technique, we have made this discovery or this observation of 6 and 8 electron bubbles. And I'm going to tell you about how they are formed depending on the amount of time. And of course, what next, what's new about this. I must acknowledge this work was primarily done by Neha, who was a PhD student and is now a postdoc at Berkeley with the Hafner Group. Funding from SERB, Harris Kari Ward, is most gratefully acknowledged. Also, apart from Neha, who primarily did this work, I must thank Prashanjit Sen, who's my colleague at SENS, and Vaishak, who was a PhD student, who has also contributed to this work. Vaishak will be in the job market very soon. And so, you know, look out for him. So let me tell you a little bit about the various configurations that electron can have in helium. The simplest example will be that of a single electron bubble. In this particular case, if the red are helium atoms, and if you put an energetic electron inside the liquid, the electron will come in and it will push away the helium atoms. And this is simply to do with the fact that the electrons in helium, they are closed shells, and therefore there is an exchange repulsive interaction between the extra electron and the electrons of helium atoms. So the helium atoms are pushed away, and in this tiny little cavity, the electron sort of gets self-localized. And the picture that you see on the right top corner is sort of what really governs the basic physics of this system. So you have some bubble surface, some cavity surface, and this surface is stabilized by two forces. The surface tension tries to collapse the cavity, or if you have any positive pressure applied to the liquid, it also tries to make the cavity smaller. On the other hand, the strong quantum confinement of whatever is inside, be it one or many electrons, that pressure due to the electron pushes the bubble surface away. So what gets formed is really a subtle counterplay of the quantum and the surface and applied pressure effects. So this is the reason this is the sort of dynamics that governs the configurations of all of these systems. This is the case of a single electron bubble. If you want to know the size of this system, in the simplest case, you can write the total energy as a sum of surface energy, where sigma is the surface tension, the thermodynamic work done to create this volume, where P is the pressure applied to the liquid, and the quantum mechanical zero point energy of this system. Okay, so if you now minimize this energy, because you have a 1/r² term and r² term at zero pressure, the energy gets minimized at 2 nanometers. What this means is, in the simplest case, you are going to be forming a 2 nanometer radius quantum dot with a single electron inside. I call this the single electron bubble, or SEB, and everything is with respect to this system that I'm going to go further. So this is, of course, not the only configuration. So in the simplest case, you can imagine that this bubble, of course, will have its surface and volume energy always the same, but then it might have, the electron can be in a different quantum state. It did not be in the ground state like the one that I showed before. And these experiments were done long time back, in which the ground state energy, you can shine light, which is of the order of 10 microns or so, and actually get it excited to a different energy state. And as the electronic energy state changes, the bubble shape also sort of changes to conform around the electronic wave function. So this will be the picture of an excited electron bubble. Similarly, you can think that there is some flow in the liquid. And one of the examples that you will see quite often are fluid flow due to quantized vortices. So superfluid helium can sustain these vortex lines around, and this around this vortex line, the fluid flow is quantized, given by this formula. And just like tornadoes can trap things, these vortex lines can trap your 2-nanometer electron bubbles or, you know, other objects. So because of the kinetic energy of the circulating fluid flow, there can be further corrections to the energy. So then these objects are also of, you know, another way in which electrons can exist in superfluid helium. So this, all these examples are with respect to single electrons inside a bubble state, but then you can also have multiple electrons, and, you know, and whether it's many or few, that will be discussed later. But then in principle, it is also possible to have a bunch of electrons all inside this tiny little cavity. I need to tell you a little bit about how these are formed. So typically these multi-electron bubbles are formed through some form of an instability of a charged interface. This is not, this is somewhat related to our talk. So far I have talked to you, I've told you about the many ways in which electrons can stay inside. You know, you can stay inside the liquid through a single electron cavity state or a multiple electron cavity state. You can excite this electron to multiple different energy states or get them trapped on a vortex line. But then there is also a possibility in which electrons can float above the liquid. And this is a very, very important field in its own right. I'm not going to tell you much about it. But then in principle, and this has been shown, that you can take these charged interfaces, charged liquid interfaces, and then there can be certain types of instabilities which can result in bubbles of forming this sort of multiple electrons. Okay, I'll tell you a little bit more about this in the next slide. So what you are seeing here is a charged interface at a very high electric field. These bubbles, these electrons, the surface can become unstable, and bubbles like this are formed. Okay, these bubbles can be directly measured. They're not nanometer size. Depending on the number of electrons, they can be basically macroscopic, and they can be imaged in a camera. Now, if you look at these bubbles that is formed, the electrons are all inside this bubble, but all repelling each other and pushing away as little dimples on the liquid surface. So this is really what you are seeing here. Each of these dimples probably are corresponding to an electron. This is a simulation, the one that you are seeing here, while the movie that you are seeing at the top is an actual movie. Of course, the electrons need not be in such a nice solid state, but then of course you can also think that they will happen in some form of a disordered state as the liquid, as shown in this picture here. Just to tell you a little bit more about the math, the energetics is primarily governed by, apart from the surface and the volume energy, the Coulomb energy of the electrons. And for at least large number of electrons, you will see that the quantum terms are basically negligible. So what you have here, at least in this particular picture, you have a completely classical interacting system, but with charges that are constrained on a surface. So what you have here is known in literature as the Thomson problem, which is exactly what I just told you, you know, how you can put interacting objects on a constraint on a surface. The only slight difference here is this is a slightly flexible surface. So this is sort of the soft version of a Thomson problem. Remember, there is still no quantum effects. Later, I'll tell you how it becomes soft and quantum analog of the Thomson problem. We have done a lot of work on this. This is one of the, including a recent review that we wrote on these objects. This is the classic picture of electrons that are residing on the surface of a multi-electron bubble. Of course, they need not be in a solid state, but they can also be in this sort of a disordered liquid state. Okay, so this is where I basically what has been done in the past. And I have already told you about how this classical multi-electron bubbles have been studied in great detail. Now, the question that sort of automatically arises, you know, you have this, what happens when the number of electrons in this multi-electron bubbles are reduced? Now, if you think about the case for a single bubble with just 3 electrons, and if you, let's say you put it inside cavity, now what's going to happen is these electrons, of course, start pushing each other out, but at the same time, it's also going to push out the surface. So you can start with this sort of classical Thomson problem, put it in a flexible interface, and you can do a very simple calculation and actually see that what you have is an interesting soft quantum system in which the electrons actually are pushing away the bubble surface to form some shape like this. Now, these are not completely trivial calculations, and so far these calculations kind of carefully have been done with only these numbers, 3, 6, 8, and 12. And what Mary's group found in these calculations are that, well, there are certain stable configurations that are possible. And these stability arguments are with respect to not only minimizing the energy, but also trying to find out if this bubble is stable against small size and shape fluctuations. Remember, your bubble is, even at zero temperature, has a large quantum fluctuation. So one has to look out for the stability conditions if one were to look at them in an experiment. The results of these calculations, the bubble shapes are shown here. You can see the for the calculations for 6, 8, and 12. It's interesting that 8 electrons can exist in two possible configurations. One to the right, in which it forms the 4 electrons, and the top 4 electrons forms a perfect cube, while the other one, the other configuration of the electrons, the cubes are slightly rotated to each other. The number that you see, this typical scale bar of these objects are about 10 nanometers or so. So that sort of justifies the fact that you have to take at least the quantum confinement into account, and whether there is overlap or not, that will depend, of course, on the how much pressure you are applying, because by applying the pressure, you can put the electrons close by, and from there, the overlap term can also increase, the exchange term can also increase. The number here is extremely important that you are seeing in the brackets. So this is what the calculations suggest are the window of stability. So these bubbles are only stable in a small pressure range. If the pressure is very high, they're going to break into smaller single electron bubbles. If the pressure is very, very negative, they're just going to explode, which I'll tell you in the next two or three slides. So as you can see, these are the shapes in which 6, 8, and 12, in which there is a possibility of the bubbles being stable at zero bars, which means they would be able to, you would be able to create them in an experiment. So these are the sort of candidates that we wanted to discover when you start doing these experiments. Okay, so I wonder how time-wise, a little slow, but the key question right now are, these are the summary of possible configurations in which the single electron bubbles exist. These are the multi-electron bubbles that have been seen in the past. The key point to note is the single electron bubbles, although they are strongly quantum confined, these are single and therefore there are no interactions. The multi-electron bubbles have negligible quantum effects, but very strong Coulomb interactions. The best part about the few electron bubbles are they are both show very strong quantum effects, strong Coulomb interactions, and form this ideal soft and quantum and interacting nanomaterial. And that's what's unique about them. And this is what we have seen in the experiments. How do we see them? So how to detect this difficult species of few electron bubbles and be able to actually differentiate between them? Now, of course, to do optical absorption, all of these bubbles would have optical absorption at different energies. So that would be one way of doing it, but this will require a very large number of bubbles. That's the difficulty. It is possible to do electrical measurements, but then you would need to measure them and actually have the sensitivity of a single electron with the background of a very large number of single electron bubbles. So, you know, in the, all the experiments, you're going to generate all these 6, 8, 12, but then there is a sea of single electrons that are present. So electrical measurements are actually very, very difficult. And the direct visualization, this imaging, you cannot do this for the 10 nanometer objects. This is only possible for this multi-electron bubbles, which are hundreds of microns. Okay, so in order to do this, we used a technique called cavitation, and this was developed at Brown University. This was also what I did during my PhD, and then we have been doing a little bit on this at IAC as well. So let me tell you a little bit about this acoustic cavitation, the experimental technique. The key idea to understand is, well, there is a pressure term in this energy. And then if the pressure term is sufficiently negative, then beyond a certain negative pressure, the energy will not have any minimum. So for the case of a single electron bubble, this is what you are seeing. When P is about minus 1.89 bars, your energy does not have a minimum, and negative pressure is nothing but stress in the liquid, which can be caused by sound. So what you are seeing here in this particular experiment, you have a focused ultrasound by a piezoelectric hemispherical transducer, ultrasonic transducer. You apply the sound, and then when the amplitude of the sound wave goes below beyond 1.9 bars, any electron that happens in that acoustic focus is just going to grow. So from a 2-nanometer objects, it can go to hundreds of microns, and then you can simply image it. So this is an extremely powerful technique to actually detect and study these electrons. So just to clarify this, when your pressure oscillation is below 1.9 bars, your bubble will slightly oscillate in size. It will still be of the order of 2 nanometers or so, and nothing will happen. You won't see anything. If the pressure oscillation is beyond a certain value, then well, at the negative pressure cycle, the bubble is just going to explode and you will be able to image them directly. And this is what we do in our experiments. So typically we apply this ultrasound. And sorry, is there a comment?
Okay. Yeah, no, 5 minutes, Avik here.
Okay, so typically we apply this ultrasound, and then what you see is some form of a probability of cavitation as a function of voltage. And the key point is this critical pressure depends on the type of bubbles we have. Basically, it depends on all the other energy terms. So a simple example will be, you can start with a ground state bubble and you will see at a certain threshold, this critical pressure in which it explodes. But then when you shine light of the right wavelength to excite this bubble into the excited state, you are going to see them at a different threshold. So this is really what we see. So this has been done and has been studied in great detail. And this is the key technique that we use to observe and detect our few electron bubbles. The theoretical predictions, which shows that the critical pressure to explode them is significantly smaller compared to single electrons. So in our experiments, this is what we do. We have coupled cavitation technique with a charged liquid interface. And then when we apply ultrasound, this is one of the first experiments in which these objects were observed. So you're actually looking at an image of the entire liquid chamber in which we start seeing this 100 micron cavitation events. When you look at them a little bit further, we see very closely that there are actually two different species that are available. Okay, and when you look at it, the exact voltages to pressure calibration, that just comes later. But if you look at these two species a little bit carefully, we see something very interesting. When we apply the first pulse, you can see them, but then very close by, consecutively apply the second pulse, we don't see anything. So what that suggests is whatever these objects are, the act of cavitation actually destroys them, and probably it goes into single electron bubbles. The another interesting thing about this particular objects is that if you look at their trajectory, and that's actually not, this movie is not playing, these objects are always traced about some form of either a ring or certain types of curved paths. And we believe this is simply because they are moving along the quantized vortex lines, which are almost always a little bit flexible in nature. And we believe that this is a very, very simple way to make images and movies of quantum turbulence, which is something a lot of people are studying right now. So I will spare you the details, but in principle, it is possible what we have done in a course of a large number of experiments. This is really the summary of about 300 experiments that we have done. Effectively, what you are looking at is the probability of cavitation as a function of pressure. You can calibrate your voltage with respect to the voltage at which the single electron bubbles are seen, and then you can very easily see the two species of these objects, which happen at about 20% or 30% of the critical pressure of single electron bubbles. If you look at the theoretical calculations, these critical pressures correspond to about 0.6 bars and 0.38 bars, which is actually correspond to 6 electron bubbles and 8 electron bubbles. samples. Okay, now we have studied them much further. We have not seen any evidence of 12 electrons in spite of looking at them very, very carefully, which would have happened, you know, at an even lower critical pressure. So we believe they are too few, or maybe their instability needs to be probed further. These objects were stable for at least 10 milliseconds, which is really humongous in quantum, in sort of quantum material language. And actually, this is the lower limit. We believe they are more than seconds for sure. And we have seen them as high as 2 Kelvin. And during these experiments, our lowest temperature was 1.2 Kelvin. So in this entire range, we could see them. Just a little bit about the 6 and 2 8 electron bubbles. There are multiple ways of forming them. I will not tell you the, I'll again spare you the details. But really what happens is when you have a very large number of electrons coming in with a very high rate, these electrons are very quickly carried away by the surface away. Now, if the rate is very high, the microscopic dimple that gets formed can basically be, you know, if it's of the order of lambda, and if the rate and the charge density that gets formed is of the order of, you know, some density ns, the pressure due to these electrons can be larger than the surface pressure. And then these objects, these dimples can further grow and actually form tiny bubbles. So we estimate this to be something below 5 microns, which is below our imaging resolution. So we believe what happens is these bubbles of the order of few microns get formed, and then they keep on breaking further till some stable species are formed. And we believe these stable species, after all this breaking, what finally remains are your nanometer size, only 2 species, 6 and 8 eV. So this is the way things are formed with this corona discharge. It is also possible, which is a little bit more interesting, through some form of interaction of the ultrasound with the charged interface. So what I'll again spare you the bare details, which is not very important. The key point that we see is that these bubbles are formed only when the sound interacts with the liquids, with the charged surface. So there is some minimum amount duration of ultrasound that is required for us to observe these bubbles. And also, if the ultrasound source is kept parallel to the surface, that means the ultrasound actually does not reach the surface, you do not see any few electron bubbles. This is my last slide. The way, so the second way of forming these few electron bubbles through a long ultrasound is some form of a parametric instability of the charged interface. So what you see here, this equation corresponds to the dispersion relation of the capillary waves of a charged interface. You have the gravity wave, the surface tension wave, and the electron pressure wave. When you have a charged interface, the surface is taken up and down some frequency omega s. So effectively, the dispersion relation now gets modified with a new coupling term that couples the electrons with the ultrasound. And there is a form of a parametric resonance that can happen when the ultrasound is twice the frequency of the without sound frequency. And you can do a little bit of simple math from Landau and Lifshitz and find out that this instability happens at about a micron or so. So again, this is yet one more way of creating this ultrasound without doing any violent corona discharge and stuff like that. So I would like to now conclude my talk, and I'm sorry the last part was a little bit fast, but all these details are available in our paper. So the key conclusions are, you can observe the 6 and 8 electron bubbles. They are stable up to 2 Kelvin with a lifetime of more than 10, 15 milliseconds, actually much larger. That they are decorating quantized vortices is amazing because there is a lot of interest to be able to image quantum turbulence. And most importantly, it's a very unique quantum, soft quantum nanomaterial. We should be able to trap these objects in a ball trap. And then subsequently, I think we would be able to control their electron interactions, their overlap integrals by just applying pressure. So with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention and take any questions.
Thank you, Ambarish. It was interesting talk, especially with your corona discharges at the end. Very relevant. There is a question by Professor Ramakrishnan.
Yeah, Ambarish, I think it's a very nice talk. I really liked it. And I also mentioned in my introductory remark, I was looking for this. I just want to know, what limits the lifetime? You quoted something like 15 milliseconds. And is it different from 6 electrons and 8 electrons? And what happens for the 12 electron bubble? So can you...
Thank you. Yeah, thank you, Raki. That's a very good question. The 15 milliseconds is actually our experimental limitation and effectively the upper limit of what we can measure in our experiments using this technique.
Okay.
We believe that these objects should be stable forever. At least that's what the calculations suggest. So that's a very good question.
Thank you.
Sadiq, you had a question?
Yeah, excuse me. Hi, Amrish. The question is actually, when you were in your slide 8, you had this image of the charges locating themselves around a sphere and in a uniform pattern. Yes, and then you have these geometric configurations. Is there any kind of dissipative mechanism which is present in the system? Because otherwise these things will not stabilize. They'll just be dynamic and will shifting from one thing to the other, right?
Okay, so that's also quite interesting, Sadiq. So firstly, these calculations were done without assuming any dynamics in the medium outside, okay? So the way these calculations were done were looking at effectively the energetics and then trying to find out if there is any change in the energetics through shape and size fluctuations, okay? If you think about this, all these objects, multi-electron bubbles, are actually metastable because ideally you would like to, this system would actually lower its energy by breaking them into smaller electrons, but it's the surface tension that actually creates a small metastable barrier. Now, the dissipative, if you now do this experiment, not in helium-4, but maybe in helium-3 in about 20 millikelvin or so, that's effectively a highly viscous medium as opposed to helium-4, which is, you know, a superfluid. Now, there, I think the stability would only be enhanced. So if you're thinking about dissipative mechanism of this liquid surrounding the bubble, then that would stabilize them. The electrons do not interact with this liquid in any direct way apart from the short-range Coulomb repulsion. There will be a small amount of polarization interaction, which we believe will further stabilize the bubble. You can ignore all the other interactions.
Great, thanks.
Okay, so we will move forward in the interest of time. Thank you again, Ambarish. Our next speaker is Chiranjeev Mitra from ICER Kolkata. Chiranjeev, over to you.
Thanks, Avik. Shall I start presenting?
Yes, please. Yes, please. So you have 25 minutes
plus
5 minutes for questions.
So how do I present? Screen. Share screen, right?
That's right. Share your screen.
So is it coming now?
Yes, we can see your screen.
A full screen, right?
Yes, absolutely. Perfect. Go ahead.
Yeah. So I'd like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to give this talk here at the QMAT. So I'm going to talk on topological insulators and more pertinently, a very recent work that we had done on the photocurrent on 3D topological insulators. So to start with, I would very give a very brief, let's say 1 minute introduction to topological insulators in the interest of time, and then signature of topological insulator from transport experiments, and then growth and characterization of thin film, but PLD. Interesting aspects here, like surface to bulk coupling. Then there were some noise measurement we did with Avik, and I'll just present the data to corroborate the finding from transport experiments. And finally, basically the bulk of the section is photocurrent measurements. So very briefly, we have band insulators where we have a very strong marked gap between the conduction band and the valence band. And one of the earliest topological insulator is the quantum Hall state, where we have these. Just let me click on the pointer. Is there a pointer that can be switched on here? No, pointer options. Yes, there's a pointer. Right. Yeah, so where we have these cyclotron orbits in the bulk, which do not exhibit any transport, but at the edge, what happens? We have this hopping, skipping orbits, which will give a linear current here, and here in this direction, and in the opposite direction on the other side. And these are topologically protected as there is no backscattering. There is no level it can backscatter. And the we have in the energy spectrum, like this is the edge states, which are topologically protected. And the 2D analog of this, where so in this case, in quantum Hall effect, the time reversal symmetry is broken by the external magnetic field, but we have these time reversal invariant topological insulators, which are the quantum spin Hall state, where it is the spin orbit coupling which splits the spin down and spin up electron channels. And here also, in absence of any external magnetic field, the spin up electron cannot actually scatter into the spin down electron channel. So this is also topologically protected, and the gapless states, edge states, are given like this. So this was taken from this reference. And then we have the 3D topological insulator, which is a kind of an extension, but of course more than an extension of the 2D topological insulators. And here, instead of these just a plain linear dispersion, you also have, as we had in the 2D, we have actually a 3D Dirac cone, which is also gapless. The surface states are gapless. And of course, the bulk states, so this is the bulk conduction band, the bulk valence band, are given by this. This is a result obtained from the spin result photoemission spectroscopy by Zaidas and Mantoux. So here also, the K plus and K minus are topologically protected, as one cannot, so there is no backscattering allowed. And we have a Dirac fermions. So these are Dirac fermions, the surface states with the spin texture. In the sense, the momentum space, if you go around the momentum space at each K value, it has a distinct spin. So basically this, and the inversion symmetry also in the two, in the surface states is broken, which is not the case in the bulk. And that is actually going to be important when we do the photocurrent measurements. So what are the criteria for having a set of topological insulators? So one of the important thing is one needs to have a large spin orbit coupling. That's why most of them use bismuth in this. And there have to be a band insulator. In this case, it is actually brought about by the spin orbit coupling. And of course, the Fermi pockets include an odd number of there. It's like even number will not give you a topological insulator. And this exhibits spin structure of the Fermi pockets. So some of the material materials which have exhibited topological insulating behavior, 3D topological insulator, are bismuth selenide, bismuth telluride, Bi2SeQTe, Bi2SeTeSb. So one of the main reasons why we actually consider this and this is because in plain Bi2SE3 and Bi2TE3 to some extent, actually because of vacancy, there are parasitic doping and you have a lot of impurities in the system, and therefore the bulk actually becomes conducting, so which is actually not good for topological transport. So that's what I'll show here. So this is a very briefly the structure basically. So you have a bismuth and two inequivalent sites of selenium. So if you look from the top, it exhibits like a triangular lattice or a rectangular lattice. And so one of the things, so why BSTS and BST? So these are the two samples that we are studying here. So Bi2SE2TE, which is BST, and Bi2 minus X, SBX, TE1 minus Y, SEY, which is BSTS. So why these samples? Because most of the time what happens, this the Fermi level actually would lie either in the valence band or in the conduction. So you have a mixture of both surface as well as positive electrons participating in the conduction. So I do not want that. You do not want that. And that is the reason why it is better to move these by actually doping, or another possibility is to do gating. By gating, actually electrical gating, you can move it into the bulk, into the gap. So this is what we are doing here, using varying the deposition condition and taking various targets. We are actually trying to push the Fermi level into the gap. So this is the one of the ways to characterize these systems, just like graphene is through graphene, and BST and BS are characteristic domains here. So this is bismuth selenide, and this is Bi2Se2Te. Without going into the details, let me go. So we did the elemental analysis also after verifying to verify that this is indeed. So this is an AFM picture which actually gives you that you have these grains which are like triangular, as I promised before. And one of the things you can see that these films are actually very high quality epitaxial films, that they are C-axis oriented. So that is actually good, because there was a lot of effort which took place in order to obtain these high quality films, and all credit to the students. So this is a bulk insulating topological insulator where you see that it behaves like a perfectly insulator. So this is important in order to get it into a topological insulating regime, or rather what we call is topological transport. So there are other examples. You see, this is bismuth selenide, which I talked about before. So you see that this behaves like a metal, okay? And as opposed to that, there is this BSTS or BST, which actually behave like an insulator. So purely by playing with the different compositions and growth parameters, etc., you can actually go from one type, like this is basically a bulk conducting, to bulk insulating or topological transport regime. But both of them actually, even if this is bulk conducting, but if you go down to low temperatures, you will see this what is called being an anti-localization effect. So the conductance actually comes down. Here actually we have plotted the resistance. But one thing we see that if we can actually get rid of any bulk carriers, then you will see that the phase coherence length actually increases, and you have a sharper actually. So this, just to briefly capture what is this weak anti-localization. So this is weak localization and anti-localization. In weak localization, which is a more common phenomenon, what happens is the forward path and the time reverse path, they interfere constructively. However, here, in absence of any magnetic field, the forward path and the reverse and the time reverse path actually interfere destructively. And when you switch on the magnetic field, so that the phase coherence, so this is the phase coherence, the phase over which the length over which the phase remains coherent. So that is reduced, and therefore you have a reduction in the conductivity. Okay. So and the topological protection is also killed. Another way to see this is that in absence of magnetic field, the spin up level cannot go to the spin down level. I mean, the spin up channel cannot cross over the spin down channel. But when you have a magnetic field, you have a path you're opening up so that they can go from one channel to the other. So this is the equation that is fitted. I have another slide with the details of this. Yeah. So delta GB. So this is the phase coherence length. So delta GB, which is a change in the conduction, is alpha. Now alpha is something which I am going to talk about in this work. Here is equal to psi times the character. This is the diagram function, which actually takes care of the similarity of the logarithmic function. And B phi is given here in terms of the phase coherence length. And alpha tells us that the dimensionality of the conduction. So for instance, how many independent number of channels are there? So supposing this thing, let's say this is the topological insulator. You have the top surface and the bottom surface. So each surface contributes to an alpha equal to minus half. And if the two surfaces are decoupled, then we will have an alpha going to be 1. So this is what we had actually verified. So we took, let's say here we have two films again, which is one is metallic and another is insulating. And okay, so we compare that the alpha actually varies. Okay, so this is the alpha E, and this is more or less consistent, but alpha can actually vary, and this can also be a function of temperature. So if it is a very, very in the topological transport region, then alpha goes towards 1, otherwise alpha goes towards 0.5. This goes. So in order to verify, to resolve this issue of alpha, so we actually made two samples. One is 200 nanometer thick, another is 500 nanometer thick, and they were both bulk insulating. And the third sample, which was again a control sample, this is 200 nanometer thick, but it was bulk metallic, just by varying the deposition condition. You can actually do that. So so here we found, so this is actually the insulating one, and these are the fit to the HLN equation. So this is sample one, let's say, and this is sample two. In both the samples, we were able to see that the alpha actually is point, alpha is actually 1. And in the other sample, which is this, which is B3, we saw that the alpha is close to 0.5. So there are certain things that I would like to say about these two samples. You see that that basically you have this insulating behavior going, and then it's deviating. So one of the reasons why it is coming, why it is going down, is because you see there are two competing channels. So of course, the bulk part is there, and then at low temperature, the at the onset of anti-localization, the conduction, the surface conduction improves dramatically, and that is the reason why this tends to saturate or concern. Now this can actually be fitted to, people have fitted to various models, so either activated behavior or not variable in coupling model. So if you fit to the activated behavior, so you can actually see, so we have actually shown that there are, so let's say this is the Fermi level, so this is the, by fitting we got this picture, is that there is these defect centers here, which probably could be either selenium vacancies or antimony. So from here, so we actually by fitting, we found out that the level is actually 23.4 millielectron volt below the conduction band. So this is the, so if I just forget the bulk bands, then just taking the cone, so this is where it will lie. And our Fermi level is, this will be like, if this is the Fermi level, so it will be about 23.45 millielectron volts above the Fermi level. So there are two phenomena happening here. So one is either you have a very, the film quite thick, so that the two surfaces are very, very decoupled. When it is thin, they tend to so they tunnel from one to the other. The other possibility is, even if you have a thick bulk, so this is the typically decoupled topological transport, topological surface states. However, even if you have a thick film, that's what I was trying to say, is that if the bulk starts conducting, then you can have crossover from one channel to other, and thereby it will behave like a single channel rather than two decoupled topological surface states. So this is what we verified here. And we also did some noise measurement with Avik to further take this. So this is that BSTS setup, the sample, which was the same sample which we which I had shown in the last part. And if you plot the R versus, so this is the noise measurement group that Avik is there. If there are any technical questions, you can answer. So this is the R versus T of this sample, this particular sample. And the IV characteristics show that this is linear. And if you see that this part, so if this is the completely insulating part, there is a deviation from this insulating part, and that is again because of the topological surface states coming into the picture and bringing it down. And this is the blown up low temperature part. So you see that it tends to sort of saturate. So we fitted this, the high temperature part, to the mode variable wedge popping formula. And here D go to 3 because the bulk is 3-dimensional. And so this fitted reasonably well in this regime. So now the noise measurement, so this is the basically the time series. And one of the things that we want to say is that the if you plot the power spectrum as a function of F, so we see that, okay, so this dotted line is the 1 by F. And the lowest temperature data is reasonably fine, but if you go at higher temperature, you will see that there are these telegraphic noise, which is a deviation from the 1 by F kind of thing. So this is the scale data to bring about this deviation. And you see that at higher temperatures, there are these Lorentzian kind of things about the characteristic frequency. And this data, we can just fit it then to a combination of 1 by F and a Lorentzian at a characteristic frequency. And we, by fitting, we established what are these characteristic frequencies. And we plot, okay. So we plot this FC as a function of temperature. And here also we get two characteristic length scale, where we fitted them to the Arrhenius equation and energy scale. And one was 84.5 MeV and another is 193 MeV. So these are the two impurity levels here. So so we are getting these sort of deviations, or other random telegraphic noise, because of carrier generation and recombination from these impurity levels. And again, in concomitant with the last Dirac cone-like structure that I have shown, where we established the impurity levels, so this is a more accurate way of establishing the impurity level. And there are two impurity levels. One could be because of selenium, and the other could be because of SB. So I'm going to the third part of the talk, which is actually the ongoing work, in the sense like still with the referees. So to the, this is basically where we, so this part of the work was done with Bipul Pal, my colleague. So both my student and me, we got together various equipment from both the labs and did this experiment. And the setup is as follows. Like, you have this, let's say this topological insulator film, which is put on a motorized stage so that it can be translated. So, and the beam, which is of the order of, it's a micron size beam, is falling on the surface of the topological insulator. And the geometry is such that, so this is actually important to bear in mind, because it's a very, very important aspect. So one is, let's say this is the normal to the surface of the topological insulator. And with respect to this normal, this is the angle that the beam makes as it falls on the topological insulator. And this shaded part is the plane, which is basically the XZ plane on which the beam is falling. And there is a quarter wave plate. So this, the laser is depolarized, and the quarter wave plate is actually so this is the laser is p-polarized, and a quarter wave plate can be rotated to change the polarization of the laser on the sample. So our goal was to see whether circularly polarized light, both right and left circularly polarized light, creates any changes. So we were not the first to do it. We got the idea from another paper. And however, this was slightly different. The sample was different. One of the reasons why we chose SB2T2SE is because this has a better conversion efficiency, absorption as well as conversion efficiency. So the setup is pretty simple. So we what we do is we shine light, and we don't put any external potential, and then we measure the current, photocurrent that is generated. So I will come to the details of the photocurrent in the next slide. But this laser is chopped at a frequency, and you do a lock-in detection of the photocurrent here with the lock-in. So this is the, I call this helical photocurrent. So this is the function of, okay, so let me just again mention that the current is along the y-axis. So this is the XZ plane along with the laser is falling, and we measure the current along the y-direction. So that's why we call this JY. So JY if we plot as a function of phi. So let me just mention here. Okay, so the angles were varied. So theta equal to 15, theta equal to 35, and theta equal to 55. This is this angle. So basically that will be made for the normal. Okay. So what we saw here is that, okay, so this was, so there are two phenomena here. So one is two parameters and two phenomena. One is this angle theta, and another is the variation of the polarization phi. So the theta equal to 135 and 315 are the right circularly polarized light. And theta equal to 45 and 225 are the left circularly polarized light. So basically, this is the, let's say this is the left circularly polarized light. And theta equal to 0 and 90 and 180 are no polarization at all. Okay, that's linearly polarized light, no circular polarization. Good. So this was fitted, this equation was fitted to this formula, JC sine 2 phi plus J1 sine 4 phi plus J2 cos 4 phi plus D. So let me explain these terms. So JC is the one that is responsible for the helical photocurrent, and J1 and J2 are the part that are responsible for linear part of the photocurrent, and D is the one which is basically the independent part. So this is not dependent on any polarization.
Chiranjeev.
Yeah.
Sorry to interrupt. 2 minutes.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. So the schematic to understand this. Thing. So this is from Geddig's paper, Nature Nanotechnology, is that if I have this circularly polarized light here, and you have, so basically you have both spin up and spin down states in a system, let's say, and equal number of spin up and spin down at the surface. And if you are exciting this, so there is no net photocurrent, because the spin up electrons move in this direction, let's say, and the spin down electron move in that direction. So when you are actually exciting this using the circularly polarized light, let's say for a particular circular polarization, then this selectively excites, let's say, this brown or whatever, yeah, these green color things. And because they are excited, now they are not available at the surface for conduction. So I create a spinning band. So there will be more number of these electrons, and hence we get a net photocurrent in this direction. Okay, let me move a little faster. Yeah, so there are two phenomena in JC alone. JC, which is two phenomena for the JC, is the helicity dependent spin current, which is called circular photon photogalvanic effect, and the circular photon drag effect. Now, so this goes as, so this was fitted, basically JC was fitted as a function of theta. So there is a one component which is C1 sine theta, another C2 sine theta. Both are helical in nature. So CPGE actually gives a pure helical surface current. So basically only the angular momentum is transferred to the spin. And CPDE captures the phenomena where both angular momentum as well as the linear momentum is transferred to the spin. So the reason it increases with theta is because the larger the angle it makes with the normal, the more momentum, linear momentum, it transfers to the flip. So this is the helical part. Then we have J1, which is the linear part, and that goes as A1 sine theta. And the other part, J2, so these don't have any contribution from the surface. And this is a totally independent spin independent part, and that is basically entirely the photothermal part. So as you are heating the laser, which is creating a gradient. So let me go to the last part then, in absence of time, which is basically, okay, which is that we actually can actually control the thermoelectric current by photon polarization. So what we did in this case, okay, so I should mention that in the previous experiment here, the photon was actually incident at the center of the sample, and here we are going to one of the edges, and we see that the opposite edges contribute differently. So let me quickly explain this, and then I'll stop. So basically here what happens is there are two phenomena. So again we fit this equation, so dy here to that equation, and the various parameters, which is basically JC, J1, J2, and D are plotted here for the two edges. And there are two angles that we take, theta equal to plus 55 and minus 55. Now, let me just explain. Like, if I have, this is, let's say, plus 55 falling on the sample, and this is minus 55. So if the plus 55 falling on this angle gives you like right circularly polarized light, let's say this is the case. And if we bring left circularly polarized light from minus 55, so they are equivalent, okay? Because they will impart the same angular momentum. So yeah, so quickly, so on edge one, we see that the, let's say at theta, phi equal to 135, and phi equal to 315, which are the right circular polarized lights, it is lower than LCP polarized LCP photons, which is at 45 or 225. And this is near edge one. And edge two, it is the opposite, which happens. So why? So just to summarize this result, okay, so is that why? What happens is, supposing I'm impinging the laser here, then it will create a thermal gradient from here to here. So the thermal gradient will be in this direction. Now, supposing I am exciting S1, let's say it's spin 1, and then spin 1 was moving in this direction, then the spin 2, which was anyway moving in this direction, this current will be enhanced. So in one direction, so if we put the photon here, we see there is an enhancement of photocurrent in this direction. On the opposite case, if we put the photon here on the other edge, then we see that there is a reduction in photocurrent. Why? Because let's say the spin current will be in the same direction, but the thermal gradient will be in the opposite direction. So the thermal, so these materials are very good photoelectric materials. So the thermal current would be in the opposite direction. So we see that in the two opposite edges, in this case, there is an enhancement of photocurrent. And in this case, there is a reduction in photocurrent in the opposite edges. Okay, so let me just conclude. So we exhibited successful synthesis of bulk insulating films for PLD, and we see reduced defect and enhanced surface conduction in the films. So establish connection between the fermion dynamics with heat anti-evaporation only by looking at R versus T behavior. Then, so we had sort out the controversial alpha dependence in various films, which people have reported without very good understanding, but we were able to see that actually you can, by controlling the going into the topological transport regime, you can actually enhance alpha to 1 from 0.5. So noise measurements can prove the recombination generation of the surface charge carriers due to the localized bulk impurities. And the topological photocurrent can distinguish between surface and bulk carriers, and it can also be used to enhance thermoelectric device application. So let me thank collaborators, Gopal, Saurav, and Jeet were the students. Avik, we collaborated with him on this noise measurement. Samram was a student. And Bipul and Samrat Roy was Bipul's student. We collaborated on the photocurrent measurements. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chiranjeev, for the nice talk. Any questions?
I have a question, Avi. Can I go ahead?
Yes, please. Yes,
Patnaik.
Yes,
yeah.
Chiranjeev, thank you. Very nice talk, very interesting. I have a very naive question. I mean, these are films. So I understand that the topological states, the eight states, both in your resistivity measurement and your photoconducting measurements, how do you ensure that you are really assessing the topological states, not the interior? Because these are films, right?
Yes. So one quick way to answer this question. Okay, so I understand your point, but I also would like to say ki these are, there is of course an assumption here is that, these films are epitaxial films. And the assumption is as follows, is that these grains, so there will be a grain boundary, of course, but these systems, because they are topologically protected, they can go from one grain to the other without actually any inhibition. And we have seen that by varying the grain sizes also. And in one case, so we had done one measurement in Avik's lab only in dilution refrigerator, and where we have seen that the L5, which is the phase coherence length, is significantly larger, much, much larger than the grain size. So which means that the topological protection actually goes beyond the grains. And as you, as with the photon, like, of course, photon will penetrate into the bulk also, but what actually prevents it from, so let me just quickly see if I have that equation here somewhere. No, I forgot to put that equation here. So actually, let me just quickly mention here is that there is a, so let me read out from one paper. So there are two, so there is a tensor equation which goes from, which captures the photogalvanic effect and the drag effect. Now the point is there is a parameter which is called gamma in the coefficient of that current, photocurrent, which actually is zero for the bulk. The reason why it is zero for the bulk is because of the inversion symmetry there, which the inversion symmetry is not there in the surface state, but that is what creates the surface state because of the Mann inversion. So the photocurrent by taking that tensor gamma is completely zero for in the photocurrent expression, the coefficient gamma is zero for bulk because of the inversion symmetry. So there cannot be any, so that is what Gedig and some of the other people say, that there cannot be any contribution to the photocurrent or to the helical photocurrent from the bulk. So it's purely like the mathematics captures it. So that is the answer to the second part.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. So thank you, Chiranjeev. I think we will have to end the session, your question and answer session here, in interest of time. You can, of course, continue the discussions in Slack or in the chat room.
This paper is in archive, so you can read it. Details are there. Yeah. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Chiranjeev. So the third speaker today is Kaustav Manna from IIT Delhi. So Chiranjeev, if you can stop sharing.
Just a second. Yes. I'll stop sharing. This computer got hung. Just a second. But can you actually block the thing? Once. Okay. So has it stopped?
Yes, it has stopped.
Yes, it has stopped.
Oh, hi, good morning. I just shared. Is it visible?
Yes, Kaustav, it's visible. Oh,
thanks.
So Kaustav, just a reminder, 25 yes. plus 5.
Thank you. So this is visible, right?
Yes, perfectly.
Okay, let me just, there is on the top. Okay, sorry. Okay, so first I'd like to, I'm Kaustav Manna from IIT Delhi. This is something. Okay. So good morning, everyone. I am Kaustav Manna from IIT Delhi Physics Department. So first, I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me to give a talk in this nice conference. And so secondly, I'd like to acknowledge to these funding agencies for providing support to my new lab in IIT Delhi. And let me now continue to the talk. So as you know that this field, Avik, is there a slight swing in the top something or it's in my screen only?
No, it's perfect. I can see it full screen.
Okay, thank you. Because it's probably in my screen then. No problem. So as you know, that this topological field, this is one of the most intense field research work today. And because of a lot of promising applications, starting from dissipationless electronics to quantum computing and next generation spintronic applications. So there is nothing much to tell about the importance of this research field, but I think in this audience, I no need to give basic introduction of topological states. And also thanks to Professor Chiranjeev for nice introductory part. So I'll directly go into the topological states classification and continue the talk. So, So the different topological states, they can be classified in a different class depending on the crystalline symmetry and strength of the spin orbit coupling in this manner. So let's see that we have a band inversion, then across the common crossing point, we have this crossing point. It is a nodal line which can be protected by the crystalline symmetry. And this is actually the picture of a nodal line semi-metals. Now, after incorporating the spin orbit coupling, depending on the strength and as well as the crystalline symmetry, that can be two different pictures. Either in the bulk, it can be fully gapped out, or we have the protected surface state whose dispersion follows the Dirac cone. And this is the picture of topological insulator. Or in the bulk itself, instead of fully gapped out, there can be protected band crossing because of the certain crystalline symmetry. And depending on situation, we can have either Dirac or Weyl semi-metals. Now in Dirac semi-metals, in the bulk, we have this protected band crossing. This is actually 440 band crossing. And the example is the sodium 3 bismuth or cadmium arsenide, this kind of materials. And this quasi-particle excitation of the electrons at this crossing point, they follows the Dirac equation in high energy physics. That is why this is called the Dirac semi-metals. Now in Weyl semi-metals, apart from this picture, either we can have either time reversal symmetry broken or inversion symmetry broken conditions. So in either of these two conditions, this four-fold degenerate band crossing splits into two-fold degenerate band crossing. And the quasi-particle excitation at this band crossing, it follows the Weyl equation, which is predicted in high energy. So that is why these kind of materials are called the Weyl semi-metals. And this is the broad picture of the Weyl semi-metals. So in the bulk, we have these Weyl points, which always appear in pairs in the Brillouin zone. And these act as a source and sink of the Very curvature. And on the surface, these Weyl points, they are connected by the quantum state, which is called the Fermi arc. Now, this quantized flux of the Very curvature, which is coming out from each of these Weyl points, they are actually, this quantized flux is called the Chern number. Now, in the talk, I'll detail come into, again, discussion about the importance of the Chern number and these topological states, etc. I'm going to discuss in detail. But let's talk a little bit further about these two classes of Weyl fermions that I'm discussing. So first is, of course, the time reversal symmetry broken Weyl fermions. Actually, these materials are ferromagnetic in nature. The example is this cobalt-2 manganese gallium or cobalt-3 sulfur 2. And these two type of materials, they actually represent, it's a not single material, but it's a class of materials. For example, this represents a family of material, which is called cobalt-2 full Häusler compounds. And all these materials, we can have Weyl fermions because of the time reversal symmetry broken. Or this cobalt-3 is actually a class of Kagome lattice materials. And all these family of materials, it is shown that this we can have the Weyl fermion because of the time reversal symmetry broken condition. And actually, we are very proud of this work because the discovery of this work is published in Science in 2019, which came online on the same day from our group. So, but I'm not going to discuss anything further about this. But today's talk is mostly focused on time reversal symmetry protected class, which is the second class. So in this family of material, the Weyl point appears because of the inversion broken symmetry condition. So all these materials are non-magnetic in nature, not non-magnetic, it's all diamagnetic in nature. And it was first discovered in this family of compound, which is tantalum arsenide to niobium phosphide, these kind of materials. And these compounds are mostly grown by chemical vapor transport. And it is already shown that as we increase the strength of the spin orbit coupling, the distance between these two Weyl points also increases. So this was already proved in literature that this kind of material shows the time reversal symmetry broken, the time reversal symmetry protected Weyl fermions. So today's talk, it is on the chiral topological materials. So these materials, whatever I'm going to talk is actually the Weyl semi-metals, which are time reversal symmetry protected. Now, before going to the chiral topology, let me first give a little bit more introduction about the Weyl fermions, the conventional Weyl fermions. Then it will be easy to differentiate what is the importance about chiral topology. So in conventional Weyl fermions, we have this two-fold degenerate band crossing, which are connected with the Fermi arc. And the quantized flux from this Weyl point is actually plus minus one. And in these Weyl points, in these semi-metals, we have the mirror symmetry, and as a consequence, all these Weyl fermions form at the same energy. So this is the picture of the conventional Weyl fermions. And when it comes to the chiral topological materials, so this is actually a new frontier in this field because most of the, not most, I will say that all the papers, whatever I have, means it is published from our group, it's actually in last 2 years. As you see that a lot of other papers are also in process of publication in similar journals. So this is one of the most important research field today in topology. So let me go into a little bit details about this. But before that, let me explain what is the importance of chiral structure. So we'll start the talk from there. So what is the definition of a chiral object? The classical definition is that a object is called chiral if we cannot superimpose its mirror object on top of each other. Then that object is called chiral. And if you look into today's molecular industry or say like drug industry, then you will find that nearly 56% of the molecules are chiral objects. But if you do a chemical synthesis of these molecules, there is always 50% probability that both these left-handed and right-handed molecules, they appear at the same time. So there is 50% probability of getting left-handed and 50% probability of getting right-handed molecules. But if you look into the biological objects, for example, say, let's say RNA, DNA, or sugars, we always have right-handed molecules, whereas in amino acids, we always have left-handed. So this is a question, or we don't know how nature always filters one kind of chiral object to build the biological subjects. So if we can know the hidden energy, then we can understand what is the origin of life in Earth. So this is actually the subject of 2021, this year's Nobel Prize in Chemistry, where it is shown that how we can enzyme the chemical synthesis so that we can bias one kind of molecule synthesis. So that is how you understand that the chiral objects are very important. And in this talk, you will understand now that chiral objects, the solid state chiral materials are also very, very important. So before going to the chiral crystals, let me give you the background. So this work started back in 2016 when this paper came in Science, which predicted that in solid state materials, we are not bound to have only two-fold degenerate band crossing, but we can have instead three-fold, four-fold, six-fold, even eight-fold degenerate band crossing. And in later, there has been many experimental reports where it is experimentally shown that indeed there can be this kind of multifold band crossing. Now, important of this multifold band crossing is that the quasi-particle excitation of the electrons at this crossing point, they have no counterpart with the high energy. They can exist only in the solid state materials. So this kind of quasi-particle excitation, that's why they are classified as the new Fermi excitations. Now, important point at this point here is that these materials, whatever is experimentally observed, the multifold band crossing, neither of them is quite fermions. So they are simply showing the multifold band crossing exists. Later in 2017, it is shown that there is possible that there is a family of compounds. So these rhodium, silicon to palladium, gallium, they belong to chiral crystals. So they have the crystal structure, B20 crystal structure. And in all these materials, we can have multifold band crossing at the high symmetric points. Like at the gamma point, we can have four-fold degenerate band crossing, or R point, we can have six-fold degenerate band crossing. An important point here is that this multifold band crossing, they represents wild fermions. Wild fermions with charge number plus or minus four, where this quantized flux, very far, the very curvature coming from this wild fermion, this is four times larger than any conventional wild fermion that has been predicted so far. So as you see that obvious thing is that the application or the physical properties that you should expect from the wild fermion in this case, which has the impact from the charge number, we should expect four times larger impact here in this family of materials. That is why these materials are so extraordinary materials. So after this theoretical prediction, first thing is that the experimental verification we need to do, we need to grow the crystals and we need to find out actually whether we can have this multifold band crossing there or not, or this multifold band crossing represents a wild fermion or not. Then comes its practical applications. So to do that, we grow the single crystals. Actually, I have grown single crystal of all these materials which represents the family in this family of compounds, B20 crystal structure. And as you see that I had to tune the crystal growth technique as well as the methods, because you will see in the experimental results like that sample quality has huge impact on the experimental results. Whether how the data will come, that represents, that is highly influenced by the quality of the single crystals. For example, cobalt silicide, this single crystal can be grown by chemical vapor transport, Richman flux, even optical fruiting zone. But the best quality single crystal is only the flux grown single crystals. All are single crystals, but quality is significantly different from batch to batch, depending on how you grow the crystals. So most likely that is why all the work so far, most of the work is published from our group only in this field. Anyway, let's go to the experimental verification. So this is the experimental result on a particular compound, which is platinum aluminium. And this is our RPS result, where you can see that at gamma and R point, indeed, we observe the multifold band crossing, which is fourfold and sixfold degenerate band crossing at the high symmetric points. Now, next point is that whether this multifold band crossing represents oil or not. So the characteristic signature of whether this is oil or not, we need to look into the surface states, whether this multifold band crossing shows any surface states or not. So this is our RPS result. As you can see that we clearly observe the Fermi arc, which expands throughout the Brillouin zone. And this is the longest possible Fermi arc that can exist in nature, because Fermi arc expands throughout the Brillouin zone. So this is our result of one particular compound, which is platinum aluminium. We have the same results on cobalt silicide as well as rhodium silicide. So these are the candidate material in this family, and all cases we observe a multifold band crossing as well as the Fermi arc. As you see, quality of the data in cobalt silicide, rhodium silicide is not that good like aluminium platinum because of the crystal quality. Later we have improved it, but important message here is that these are the first candidate material where we observe the multifold band crossing and the existence of wild fermions. Next is, how about the controllability of this topological state? Can we have the controllability of the topological state so that for the real practical applications, we can tune the topological states? So for that, as you know, that topological states are bound with the crystalline symmetry. So important point here is that if we can tune the crystal symmetry, then there may be a possibility that we can tune the topological states as well. So what is the impact of the symmetry with the topological state, and what we should expect? So when you go from the left-handed to right-handed crystals, because as I said that these are the chiral crystals, right? So all the samples have the same space group. Depending on the atomic arrangement, it can be either left-handed or right-handed crystals. Whether it is left-handed or right-handed, space group is still B20 crystal structure, B21/3. And all these materials, what we find is that, what we expect is that, as we go from one enantiomer to the second enantiomer, the crystal structure, the atomic arrangement is changed, as well as the crystal symmetry is changed. What the impact of this crystal symmetry on the topological state is that as the symmetry is changed, the Fermi velocity is also changed. As a consequence, when one of the wild point which was acting as the sink, or the other charge point which was acting as a source, now depending on the Fermi velocity, it will also get reversed. So now let's see the experimentally how we can observe this. For that, we do the RPS measurement, and this is done on the particular compound, which is the palladium gallium. And as you see that this material is also a candidate material in this family, and at the gamma and the R point, we have the multifold band crossing. So still in the same page. And as we go from one enantiomer to the second enantiomer, as you see, topological states are simply mirrored. That means as you tune the symmetry of the crystal structure, you have the possibility, you can tune the topological states also in this material. Next is that how we can verify the char number 4 in this compound that we have discussed in the beginning, whether this has these wild points are actually char number 4 or char number 1. So the char number is actually connected with the number of Fermi arcs, because you can imagine that this is a series of quantum Hall states, and this char number is actually the topological entity associated with this Fermi of these wild fermions. So char number 4 means you can imagine like 4 number of H states. As a consequence, you should observe 4 number of Fermi arcs in the compound. So if we can experimentally count the number of Fermi arcs, and if we find there are 4 number of Fermi arcs, this will directly tell us that indeed the char number of the wild point, whatever we are discussing, is actually 4. So for that, what we do is that we look into high resolution RPAs and we resolve this broad feature, whatever we observe, and we clearly observe that there is a splitting. Now the splitting is not high, because how to increase the splitting? Now, increase the splitting, what you need to do is that you need to tune the strength of the spin orbit coupling in the material. Now, how to increase the spin orbit coupling strength? That is that we replace the atoms. So here we replace palladium with platinum, and this platinum gallium is the candidate material in this family where we can have largest strength of spin orbit coupling. So when we grow the single crystal and do the RPS, we clearly observe indeed there is a huge splitting of the Fermi arc. And we, when we count, the total number of Fermi arc is actually 4. That means the Chern number or the strength of the quantized flux associated with this wild point is actually 4 in this material. So now comes the next part. What are the other ways of we can map the topological surface states, plus not topological surfaces, like the Fermi surface? So here we have discussed about the RPS measurements. That is one way that we can map the Fermi surface topology. Another way is also the quantum oscillations. So where we can map the bulk Fermi surface, the details of the bulk Fermi surface and the extremal cross-section area from these quantum oscillation frequencies. So next, what we want to discuss is the practical. What is the importance of this topological state?
2 minutes.
Sorry, hello?
2 minutes.
Oh, okay. Okay, thanks. So, importance about the topological state is that, so this paper, it in 2011, it predicts that if you put a circularly polarized light on a wild semi-metal, then you should expect quantized CpG response. This is the second order optical response. That means if you put a circularly polarized light, you should observe the DC current, the quantized DC current. And what is the rate of current generation of the DC current is proportional to the Chern number. So obviously, if we put a circularly polarized light on a wild fermion, then you should observe a quantized the current, a quantized DC current proportional to the Chern number C. But if you do the experiment on a conventional wild fermion, you will never observe this thing, because in conventional wild fermions, you have these wild points appear at the same energy. So the DC current from plus C will simply nullify minus C. So in order to observe the quantized CpG, we need to shift these wild points away from each other. And this is naturally satisfied in the chiral crystals, where instead of mirror symmetry, you have the chiral symmetry. So reflection plus translation, because you have the glide operation in chiral symmetry. So it is possible that depending on where is the Fermi energy, you can probably block one of the excitation from one of the wild point, and you can observe the quantized CpG response from the other. So we pick the crystal rhodium silicide, which is predicted to be the most promising candidate in this material with the cleanest Fermi surface. And it was predicted that we should observe 4 times larger current compared to the conventional wild fermion. But when you do the experiment, we see that the quantized CpG is not there, because there is experimental limitation. So Fermi surface, even though it is not clean from the other effect, like in M point, there is another trivial pocket, as well as in the gamma point, we have this flat band, which gives rise to a very small hot carrier lifetime. As a consequence, in the optical measurements, even though there may be the quantized CpG response, but it is hidden because of the other artifacts. So we have checked with the other crystals in this family, and all the experimental results shows that indeed we don't observe quantized CpG response. So second way is that if we can shift the Fermi level from top to bottom, maybe up or down, there is a possibility that we might observe quantized CpG in these crystals. So for that, how to shift the Fermi level is by doping. And in our recent study, we have seen that indeed it is possible to dope these crystals, and we can shift the Fermi level up or down. And right now we are doing the experimental characterizations. Let's see how the result comes. It's not yet done. So next comes is that, as you have seen that in this family of materials, it is not possible at this point to observe the quantized CpG. So what other possibilities we have? When we look into literature, it is possible we find that there is only one candidate left behind, which is the strontium silicide. And it was predicted long back in 2016 that this is the first material where it was predicted to have Chern number higher than 1, not 4, but higher than one. And it was predicted in this Nature communication paper also that indeed there is a certain frequency range where we should observe.
We are out of time.
Okay. So maybe I'll stop here. Okay, no problem.
So we have, thank you very much, Kaustav, and sorry for stopping you midway.
No problem.
There are a couple of questions, quick questions if possible. Manoranjan, please.
Kaustav, nice talk. Can you please tell us that how do you observe this six-fold degeneracy in the experiment? And what is the reason and what kind of symmetry results into this six-fold degeneracy?
In this case, six-fold, four-fold and six-fold degeneracy, what we observe is that we take the help of the RPS measurement and we just simply compare with the theoretical calculation. Whether this crossing point, it is four-fold degeneration or not, or all the other features, it is mapping exactly one-to-one correspondence or not.
Okay, basically theoretical, I mean, like...
Yes, theoretical comparison with the experiment.
And what kind of symmetry is responsible for it?
Symmetry in the sense, in this case, this is actually... I don't remember right now what is the exact symmetry that protects this band crossing. Associated with this particular this phase group P213.
Okay.
So these are also called the Cramer soil because it forms at the high symmetric points.
Okay, thank you.
Next question is by Paramita Dutta.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for the nice talk. So in your first slide, you mentioned that you have shown the figure of topological, I think, nodal line semi-metal, and you mentioned that as soon as you incorporate the spin-orbit interaction, it's not possible to get this topological nodal line semi-metal phase, if I'm correct. So my question is it not possible to find the nodal line semi-metal phase in presence of spin-orbit interaction? I'm asking because there is a paper by Jai Dashan group where they have shown that nodal line semi-metal phase in spin orbit metal. I think the material was PBTA SE2. So do you have any comment on that?
Yes. Even that's why I just froze in this slide. Let's see this material which I am showing here. This is one of the experimental like example, cobalt to manganese gallium.
Okay. Yeah.
The theory says that because of the overlapping, we have the nodal line, and the moment you incorporate spin orbit coupling, we should have the wild fermion. Okay. Now, whether you will observe the wild fermion or not, that depends on the strength of the spin orbit coupling. That is first thing.
Mm-hmm.
And in this material, cobalt, manganese, gallium, as you see that these are 3D materials, strength of SOC is very, very weak. Okay. So instead of wild fermion, what we'll observe is that wild line, because this gapping out of the nodal line, as you see here, the range of KY value, we observe the band crossing, right?
Hmm.
If it is a conventional Weyl or Dirac fermion, then instead of a line, we should observe at a particular point, right?
Yes.
But for a range of KY value, you see, we have the protected band crossing. That means whatever we observe is actually a line, not a point, discrete point. So whether it will fully gap out, so what we conclude here is that even though the theoretical prediction, what we do calculation is that it shows that indeed it gaps out because of the SOC and the ferromagnetic interactions, but gapping out is beyond the resolution of the experimental result.
Okay.
So what we observe is actually a nodal line, and even we observe the Dramer surface states also in this material, which is the like the surface state of the nodal lines.
I see.
Okay. Kaustav, thank you again for a fascinating talk. Let's move on to the next speaker, Shubhajit Sinha from TIFR.
Yeah, hi. Am I audible?
Shubhajit, you are audible.
Yeah, great. Okay, let me proceed to share the screen.
Yes, we can see your screen very well. Please, all yours.
Okay. So good morning, everyone. So first of all, I am Shubhajit Sinha, and I am pursuing my integrated PhD in the nanoelectronics group in TIFR. And before beginning, I would like to thank everyone for giving me this opportunity to present our recent work in this nice QMAT platform. And also, I would like to acknowledge my senior Pratap Chandra Adak, with whom I am doing this joint kind of work, and my guide, Professor Mandar Deshmukh. And this is kind of a collaborative work between our lab, and where we got some theory support from IIT Kanpur, from Professor Amit Agarwal's group, and from Professor Umesh Wagmare's group in Bangalore. And we also are grateful for the HBN crystals that we get from the Japanese groups, and also thanks to funding that we get. So to begin with, what I'm going to talk about today is some of our ongoing experiments using Moire superlattices to probe some quantum mechanical quantities, which is known as Berry curvature dipole. And what we do is that we probe this Berry curvature dipole and systematically can characterize topological transitions in the valley churn bands that these Moire superlattices host. So strain pace kind of plays a fundamental role in that. We will discuss this. So before beginning, let's motivate ourselves that why this Moire superlattices have emerged is kind of an hot topic in this field. The superlattice business is kind of an old, means people used to do it in 1970s, where if you have a periodicity which is kind of larger than the periodicity of your means lattice constant, one opens up super mini Brillouin zones and band gaps at the corners of the mini Brillouin zones. But with this super lattice, means this is an image from Quantum Magazine where we have two graphene sheets twisted at a very small angle, and that can create modulation of a periodicity with larger periodic constant as compared to the lattice constant. So when one does that, one has bands which are kind of this in the mini Brillouin zones, they are kind of very flat. And in these 2D materials, what one can do, as we all kind of know, that selectively place the Fermi level at specific places and study the quantum mechanical properties of individual bands. So recently there are experiments as well in this frontier, and people have explored superconductivity. Now let's first now motivate ourselves that why do we want to study the transitions in churn numbers that these bands host. So in a conventional graphene, bilayer graphene, what one has is kind of a band gap one can open in this bilayer graphene system, and at the edges of the band gaps one has a Berry curvature hotspots, which is denoted by this colors plot. And one can define something called the integral of the Berry curvature, and that gives a conductivity. But when the bands become kind of isolated, one can additionally, this integral of the Berry curvature in a specific band over the K-space of Moire Brillouin zone, they kind of become quantized integers. So what I'm going to talk about is the transitions of these numbers. So it happens, it seems to happen that one can control the churn numbers dynamically in this system by certain parameters, for example, electric field, and cause changes in this churn number. So the way to think about these churn numbers is like at the when the global time reversal symmetry is preserved, if you have a total churn number of which is non-zero, one can have edge states moving around just like the quantum Hall picture. But if we have time reversal symmetry preserved, what happens is that the churn numbers if is kind of is negative from the two valleys. Means if I have a positive churn number from the K valley, the churn number at the negative K or the K prime is just negative, so that the total conductivity is kind of zero, and one needs further ways to probe the churn number transitions because the conductivity is no longer a good measurement. So such reports do not exist that how to probe when the total churn number is zero. So we are looking in some quantum mechanical properties, which is known as Berry curvature dipole. So what is a Berry curvature dipole? So we know that we just talked about Berry curvature distribution in the bands. And when the Berry curvature distribution in a band is kind of uniform, at that time, this Berry curvature dipole is kind of zero. So when the Berry curvature dipole is non-zero, when one can kind of engineer systems in which the Berry curvature distribution in a band is non-uniform, that is some C3 symmetry or something is broken, at that time this integral gives a non-zero number. In this integral contains two things. One is the Berry curvature, and if it has a non-uniform distribution of Berry curvature, it generates a non-zero Berry curvature dipole. So it was proposed by two scientists, Sodemann and Fu, in 2015, and what they said is that there are kind of two ways in which one can engineer Berry curvature dipole. One is seen in like conventional materials like transition metal dichalcogenides, WT2, where one has a band bending. So that can create actually a non-uniform distribution of Berry curvature dipole at a finite cut and can generate Berry curvature dipole. And another way is to have strain to break the C3 symmetry, that is the spatial symmetry in the plane. And we will discuss that our experimental work kind of lies in this domain. And what happens is that when one have a non-zero Berry curvature dipole, so this is D is the Berry curvature dipole in this case here, is a vector quantity. And what we can see is that when the D is non-zero, it drives a second order response in the conductivity. So this E is in electric field, and electric field square gives a response in the second order conductivity. So we measure it, and so there are three ingredients one requires a system to measure. So what system we choose? So we have a something called twisted double bilirubin. So what twisted double bilirubin is that we take a bilirubin and cut it and stack it on top of another bilirubin at a small twist angle. So while this system has some more advantages than the conventional just twisted bilirubin, which is monolayer on top of monolayer, because this twisted double bilirubin also has additionally electric field tunability, that the band structure of its of it can be tuned by just applying perpendicular electric field. And so how we fabricate these devices is that we sandwich it in two hexagonal boron nitrides and have two gates to control, means to apply potentials and have independent control over the doping and the electric field. So in this color scale plot, what I am showing is a color scale plot of resistance as a function of this doping in the x-axis and the electric field in the y-axis. So how to understand this color scale plot? So the way to understand this color scale plot is to take line slices along the n-axis. And this is just some schematics of the density of states corresponding to that. So when I take a line slice here at a particular fixed electric field, I can see two gaps here. So that corresponds to the two gaps in this density of states. So what happens in this system is that there are two kind of flat bands.
Shubhajit.
Yeah.
2 minutes.
Oh, okay. That are kind of lying nearby. So what we'll see here is that we have another kind of ingredient, which is we have studied earlier, which is the Berry curvature hotspots in this system. Now, in this Moiré superlattices, we have strain as well. And what strain does is kind of we studied it by some calculations here, that it creates a non-uniform distribution of the Berry curvature, and that kind of generates Berry curvature dipoles in this band. And I must stress here that when the strain is kind of zero, means there is no C3 breaking here, the Berry curvature dipole remains pinned to zero. So we studied nonlinear Hall voltage, which is just the perpendicular voltage and the 2 omega component of that when we apply an electric field, and we characterize various aspects of it. And in the next part, in 1 or 2 minutes, I'll just concentrate in the nonlinear Hall close to this CNP gap. So it has been shown that one means if one normalize this nonlinear Hall conductivity, one can extract this essential number of the Berry curvature dipole via the intercept. So what we do is that we kind of study this normalized nonlinear Hall voltage normalized with this longitudinal voltage squared as a function of electric fields. And what we see surprisingly is that at a particular critical electric field, this kind of starts increasing rapidly. And this red curve corresponds to the longitudinal conductivity square in and it also has a corresponding dip in conductivity at a particular critical field. So to do this analysis, we plot it systematically using these two parameters, using dynamically this electric field as the parameter. And at a particular critical electric field, we do see a change in sign. And we can also repeat this experiment for multiple fillings. And we see that this we can extract the from the intercept, the barycurvature dipole, and that kind of decays as one increases or goes away from the gap. So this is kind of expected in the literature as well. So how to understand this sign change? So just 1 minute, I'll just conclude in two slides. So how to understand this sign change is that we did some theoretical calculations with Professor Amit Agarwal's help, and we find that there is some barycurvature exchanges going on. So what happens as we are dynamically increasing the electric field is that these flat bands are kind of which have barycurvature hotspots, they kind of touch these higher lying moire means dispersive bands, and they kind of exchange barycurvature. So you can see here this in this color scale plots that as this delta, which is a dummy for electric field, is increased, one has this barycurvature signs kind of get flipped. And one using that, one can kind of plot the color scale plot for barycurvature dipole as well, which is where the Z2 index is now defined as the difference between the Chern numbers for the two bands. And the way to understand this plot is as we go along a particular filling, which is this band, at a critical electric field, when the Z2 kind of flips, goes from zero, two to zero, it is accompanied by a simultaneous change in sign of the barycurvature dipole. So this we kind of have extracted in our experiments. And so let me summarize here quickly that in general, the probing of topological Chern numbers in the valley Chern type is kind of challenging. And we use this twisted double bilayer graphene to kind of study nonlinear Hall voltage. And our measurement and subsequent analysis shows that this nonlinear Hall effect can be a good probe for these topological transitions of the valley Chern bands. I thank you for your kind attention, and I'm open to questions. Thanks.
Thank you, Shubhajit. Very nice work. In the interest of time, we will not have any questions. I would encourage people to use the breakout room or the Slack to discuss the questions. The next speaker is Arno Bera from ISES.
Hello.
Yes or no? We can hear you.
Okay. Is my screen visible?
Yes. Yes. You're all ready.
Okay. So, good morning.
Arnab, can you switch on your video?
Oh. Okay. Good morning. I am Arnab Bera. I am doing my PhD at Indian Association for the Cultivation of Science, Kolkata. So, today I am going to talk about temperature induced inversion symmetry breaking structural transition in MOTE2. Okay, so first I will discuss about transition metal dichalcogenides. So transition metal dichalcogenides is a series of material with generic structure MX2, where M is the transition metal like niobium, tantalum, molybdenum, tungsten, etc., and X is the chalcogen. So this material shows some interesting features, like they are layered and they are attracted by weak van der Waals forces, and the in-plane conductivity of this material is very high. Also, number two, they can exist in three possible structures. First is 1T prime structure, which is monoclinic, and then TD structure, which is orthorhombic, and 2H structure, which is hexagonal. The electronic properties of this material is highly associated with its structural phases. For example, if you consider 2H phase, this is primarily semiconducting in nature. And then 1T prime phase is typically semi-metallic, and TD phase is candidate of oil semi-metal. Number four, due to strong high Z value of this material, this shows strong spin orbit coupling. And one interesting phenomenon is that the phase engineering as phase transition can easily achievable for this material, and the tuning parameter is like temperature, pressure, electric field, etc. So for MOTE2 is a special among the TMDs because it can stabilize in all of three phases. At a room temperature, MOTE2 exists as hexagonal structure or monoclinic structure, and at low temperature, it exists in orthorhombic structure, which is TD phase. The important properties of MOTE2 is that for 2H MOTE2, which is semiconducting in nature, shows indirect band gap around 0.8 electron volt. And as these materials are layered, so when we go from bulk to few layer, there is a indirect band gap to direct band gap transition. And for monolayer MOTE2, it is found to be direct band gap is around 1 electron volt. And for TDMOTE2, it is type 2 oil semi-metal, and it shows superconductivity below 0.1 Kelvin. And for 1D prime MOTE2, it is semi-metallic in nature. And when we go from bulk to few layer, there is evidence of band gap opening around 60 milli electron volt for 1D prime MOTE2. So one important thing to mention is that TD phase is a non-centrosymmetric phase, and 1D prime phase is centrosymmetric phase. So here we calculate density DFT of 1T prime MOTE2 and TD MOTE2. And here we can see in TD MOTE2, there is a band crossing in Fermi level. So electronic structure of the TD phase indicates that it is topological oil semi-metal. Now I will discuss my growth procedure. So first, I prepare my polycrystalline sample. So to prepare this, we make a stoichiometric mixture and put it in a furnace and heat it at 1200 degree centigrade temperature. One important thing is that 1T prime phase exists at high temperature. So when we cool down slowly, the 1T prime phase transform to 2H phase. But we need to stabilize the 1T prime phase. So what we do is that we did ice water quenching. So then we can get the 1T prime phase. And we did powder XRD. This is fitted quite nicely. And space group is P21 by M. So to get a single crystal from polycrystalline sample, and we did chemical vapor transport method. Here we put polycrystalline MOTE2 and with iodine in a quartz tube. Here iodine is a transport agent, and this quartz tube is we put in a two-zone furnace, and we maintain hot zone temperature is around 1100 degree centigrade, and cold zone temperature is 1000 degree centigrade. So after following the same ice water quenching, we can get a shiny needle-like crystal of MOTE2. And this crystal size is around, length is around 3 to 4 mm. And then we did powder XRD, and from this XRD, we confirmed that this is 1T prime MOTE2. So then we did some basic characterization using XPS. So here we can see that MO3D peaks and tellurium 3D peaks are there. And these peaks are fitted quite nicely. And if we calculate the area under the curve of this XP spectra and do the ratio, we can get this stoichiometry ratio, and which matches with our theoretical stoichiometry ratio. Now we did 4 probe transport measurement down to 2 Kelvin. Here we here you can see that this is metallic in nature, and also there is a resistivity transition around 240 Kelvin. If we plot heating and cooling cycle data, we can see there is a hysteresis. And from the d rho by dt versus temperature graph, we can find that the heating transition point is around 264 Kelvin and cooling transition point is around 234 Kelvin. So we need to explore what is the reason behind this resistivity transition. So that we did temperature dependent XRD study, and we can get that for 1T prime MOTE2, at high room temperature, we can get 1T prime MOTE2, and when we cool down it, the sample, it transformed to TD MOTE2. So there is a structural transition. So as I mentioned earlier, this structural transition point is around 240 Kelvin, so which matches with our resistivity data. So the resistivity transition is due to the structural transition. So as I mentioned earlier, that TD MOTE2 is non-central symmetry and 1T prime MOTE2 is central symmetry. So there is a symmetry breaking transition is there. So to know more about this symmetry breaking transition, we explore laser Raman spectroscopy. So here we use 532 nanometer laser source. At room temperature, all the characteristics peaks are present in MOTE2. If we cool down the sample at around 130 centimeter inverse, the out of plane vibrational mode gets splitted, and the out of plane vibrational mode at 160 centimeter inverse gets shifted. So if we plot the peak position versus temperature, we can get in heating and cooling cycle a clear hysteresis. So this transition is due to this symmetry breaking transition for 1T prime MOTE2. To know more about the structural transition, we did thermopower measurement using our homemade experimental setup. So here we use two small heater to control to maintain the temperature gradient. And using Kittle 6221 current source, we control the temperature gradient, and the response thermopower response is measured via Kittle 2182 nanovoltmeter. So in our setup, we measure the MOTE2 sample, and here we can see there is multiple transition. So we differentiated the region in three regions. So at room temperature region, which is 1T prime phase, and at low temperature region, which is TD phase. So for 1T prime phase, the Seebeck coefficient value is small and positive. If we consider the low temperature phase, the Seebeck coefficient value is changing from positive value to negative value. So this may be due to the change in majority carrier type. For positive Seebeck coefficient value, the majority carrier is like hole, and for negative Seebeck coefficient, majority carrier type is electron. So this change from positive to negative value is due to temperature agitation effect or Fermi level redistribution effect. But near this region, at around 220 Kelvin to 280 Kelvin, the Seebeck coefficient comes from the contribution of both 1T prime and TD phase. So there is a phase mixing nature is there. So we can say that polar 1T prime phase persists locally in non-polar TD phase and vice versa over the temperature range 220 Kelvin to 280 Kelvin. And as we discussed earlier from transport study and also Seebeck coefficient study, that heating transition point and cooling transition point is different. So there is a structural memory effect is there. And also we can get hysteresis nature in transport. So macroscopically we can say this is first order transition, and the nucleation island is spreading, and its spreading rate is different in heating and cooling cycle. To know more about this, we did some theoretical calculation. on Seebeck coefficient. Here we can see in orange curve is MOT to TD phase, and the blue one is MOT to 1T prime phase. So for orange one, you can see there is a zero crossing around 127 Kelvin, which matches our experimental result also. And at room temperature phase, 1T prime phase, the Seebeck coefficient value is small, and which matches with our theoretical experimental data. But in this region, this
can be explained. Yes. You have 2 minutes.
Okay, so in this region, we can explain is in via phase mixing method. And if we plot the intermixing ratio with temperature, we can see that the intermixing ratio for the two sequences evolves gradually across the transition temperature. So in conclusion, we can say that we can grow good quality of MOT2 single crystal. Then MOT2 shows structural phase transition from 1T prime phase to TD phase. The symmetry breaking transition has been confirmed by laser Raman spectroscopy. And from our thermopower measurement, we can get phase mixing behavior near the transition point. So I would like to thank my supervisor, Dr. Mintu Ondol, also my lab mates. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Arnav, for a very nice talk. Any questions? We are open to questions. Okay. So if there are no other questions, I have one question for you, Arnav. How do you know the low temperature phase? How did you characterize it? Sorry, I missed that point.
Okay. So we did a temperature dependent XRD. I just plot the structural information, but we did temperature dependent XRD, and we can see at low temperature, it is TD phase.
Okay. And you mentioned something about the interesting properties of TD, right?
This is non-central symmetric.
Yes, and in the center, in the single layer limit, it has to go to a quantum spin liquid or something, right?
Yes.
So,
yes.
Did you people do any transport measurements to verify these phases here?
Yes. Yes. Some people do arc phase measurement, I think. So, they show that the band gap value is around 60 milli electron volt for monolayer MOT2.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, Arnav. So that was the last talk of the session. Let us just, thank all the speakers again once more, and over to the organizers.
Okay, Ovid, thank you very much. So we come at the end of this session, and thanks also for keeping the time. We are just 4 minutes overshoot by 4 minutes. Okay, so the next session will start at 11:30. Let me just verify this once. Yes, that's correct. So it will be a new link. So we'll be stopping this link now.